Joel, let's talk about the NL East and with the move here now, Francisco Lindor and Carlos Carrasco coming to the Mets. And again, we just talked about the fact that there potentially still could be more moves. But how does this affect the Mets and now what's arguably one of, if not the toughest division in all of baseball?
Yeah, Fran, I think one of the things to think about with the Mets, I wonder if Sarah agrees, she's seen the team as much as me the last few years, is the Mets have underachieved their talent the last few years. They're a talented group. Late in 2019, they kind of turned it on and nearly made a run to the playoffs. Last year, you looked and thought, like, why isn't this better? Their offense was really good. It was like these last few years, whatever they needed to do not to be good enough occurred. So that needs to kind of change because on paper, I still think the Braves, because of the depth of their 26-man group and what they could bring up from the minors over a long season, especially when you're going to need a lot of arms when guys didn't pitch last year, I think the Braves are better. But on paper, the Mets are one of the four or five best teams in the National League without another move or two. And I think we all agree there's going to be another move or two here for them. But that being said, whatever's been in the water with them has to change where they play to their talent level. They, when we put up the graphic in the last segment, and you look at the group of players on the field, they're talented. Were they not performing because the defense was bad, because they didn't have depth in the bullpen, whatever it was, just bad mojo, they need to perform to their talent plus have Francisco Lindor.
Absolutely. I mean, I think to the point of underperforming, the highest weighted runs created plus in the majors last year among teams, it was the Mets and Dodgers tied at 122. So the Mets had an equal offense to the World Series champions who we saw demolish teams with their bats. So I do think that there's been an element of underperforming, and I think a lot of it comes from the pitching beyond DeGrom. But I absolutely think that they can go toe-to-toe with the Braves. And I think the Braves have their own sets of questions. They were really helped by Marcell Ozuna's offense in 2020. We don't know what team he's going to be on, and it probably won't be the Braves. They are getting back their ace or co-ace in Mike Soroka. But I do think that the Mets absolutely can be one of the best teams in the National League and certainly can win the division. But I think the division is very tough. I think that the other teams are a cut below, but you can make an argument for any of those teams, especially with potential expanded playoffs or whatever else, at least making the postseason. The Marlins are a bit of a wild card, not to use the actual phrase, because we don't really know how much of what happened in 2020 will necessarily carry over in terms of how good they were. But the Nationals have Juan Soto, who's one of the like three best players in the majors, at least position players. And the Phillies have Bryce Harper. The Phillies have good pitching in Aaron Nola and Zach Wheeler. So I think those teams have more questions, but I think any of these teams could make a run, which is interesting. This is why the Mets are loading up.
And who knows? I mean, this might spur, you know, Philly's top brass to make a move now that they see what the Mets are doing as well. And a lot of people are hopeful that they re-sign JT Realmuto. So, Dave, I mean, with the Mets and then now you got the Braves, as Sarah just talked about, and the Phillies here, what are your thoughts on where the Mets fall in the NL East?
Well, as I'm looking at this lineup right here, starting back here with the Nats who came in last, they still are missing Rendon. They have the best hitter in baseball right now in Juan Soto. They need to do something. They need the DH spot to open up because I think they can add that type of bat, maybe a Marcell Ozuna in that lineup to protect Juan Soto. Phillies, with the Mets doing that, if they want to compete, they're going to have to go out and do something. Bringing back JT Realmuto, I think, is going to be critical for them because that's a big hole in their lineup and also defensively. The Mets, I think, jump right up there. The Marlins, two-month season, I don't put a lot of weight in what we saw last year. To do it for 162 games is totally different than a quick spurt, and I think they did an amazing job. I think Don Mattingly was absolutely outstanding keeping that team together with all the COVID issues that they had and all the roster moves that they had to make. But the Mets, with this trade, and I don't believe that they're done either, I think have vaulted themselves right behind the Atlanta Braves. To me, the Atlanta Braves last year are arguably the best offensive team, right? They led all of major leagues in OPS. Adding Charlie Morton and Drew Smyly with Soroka, as you mentioned, coming back, they're a tough team. And I don't see them going away.
Well, what's this do before we jump to break here, Joel? Back pages, New York City. I mean, what's this do now, Mets Yankees?
Well, not only back pages. In my paper, it might be the front page, too, in the New York Post. This is one of those moments. And, look, it's one of those moments that the Mets as an organization and their fans live for. Because if you think about what the last 30, 50 years of back, the Steinbrenner era, starting in the mid-70s, if we started playing back pages, who's won for the last half century, that's not really close.
Right.
Right? Like, there's a team that's won a bunch of World Series, been to the playoffs pretty much every year, especially in the last 25, and the Mets have kind of underachieved, had kind of a comical run, you know, sometimes where they step on their own feet. This is a great day for them. This is a day where, like right now, if you're, I've lived in New York my whole life. I've got half, my friends are half Met fans, half Yankee fans. Thankfully, I grew up a Cincinnati Red fan. I don't care, right? But I lived here my whole life. I know the mindset of the Met fan, and I know what it is today. It's one of those days where you turned and went to your friend who's a Yankee fan and said, we got the guy this time. Because that doesn't happen an awful lot over the last 50 years.